If you encounter an example like this on a test, what should you do? Probably you need to do some scratch work first, a little experimentation. We want to prove or disprove that this set is a subring of this. You don't know the answer. You got to kind of figure it out. And maybe what you do is you kind of attempt to prove it. And if you get stuck, then maybe you say, well, maybe it's not true, but then you need to give a little reason as well. So let's go ahead and sort of assume it's true and let's attempt a proof. Attempt a proof, assuming it's true when theoretically ahead of time, you don't know for sure if it's true or not, if the problem's phrased like this. It is certainly, first of all, a non-empty set. That technically is part of the condition for being a subring, is that the set you're looking at does have to be non-empty. Well, it's obviously non-empty because A can be any integer. It's in fact an infinite set. The subring test says once you know the set is a non-empty subset of, well, this, it is a subset of this, that's the set of all matrices, 2x2 matrices with integer entries. This is a special kind of 2x2 matrix with integer entries. It's certainly a subset of that. Is it closed under subtraction and is it closed under multiplication? That's what you need to verify. If it is, then the subring test says it will be a subring of the bigger ring. So let's check closure under subtraction. Closure under subtraction. Is it true or not? Give me any two matrices in R. Is there a difference also in R? I should use a different letter for the upper right entry of the second matrix than the upper right entry of the first matrix because they could be different numbers. But the key thing to realize, I hope you realized in working through this, is to say, yes, this is an element of R since A minus B is an element of Z. If you had to give a reason, you should add that extra little piece. Maybe you didn't do that. For full credit, you should really emphasize, you know this is an element of R, not just because there's something non-zero in the upper right corner, but because A and B being at integers also has their difference being an integer. I could also add another since A and B are integers. And you could also add, this is maybe a little bit of overkill, that the integers is a group under addition. But wait a minute, there's a subtraction there. Well, subtraction is addition, right? We know that. A minus B is the same as A plus the additive inverse of B, negative B, where that represents, yeah, the inverse of B in Z as a group under addition. Closure under multiplication happens as well. This will be a subring. Closure under multiplication. Once again, you want to use a different letter in the upper right corner of the second matrix than the first matrix. You do ordinary matrix multiplication here. Upper left entry is going to be 0 times 0 plus A times 0. I'll go ahead and write it out for extra measure. 0 times 0 plus A times 0. That's the upper left entry. Upper right entry is going to be 0 times B plus A times 0. Lower left entry is going to be 0 times 0 plus 0 times 0. Lower right entry is going to be 0 times B plus 0 times 0. And yes, you all saw you got the zero matrix. We could call this big zero maybe if we like. Make it extra boldface. That's the zero matrix. That is the additive identity in this ring M2Z. It's a ring. I mean, it's a group, a commutative group, an abelian group under addition. The identity of that ring, the zero, is not the identity matrix. It's the zero matrix because we're talking about it being a group under addition. So that is special, but I mean, this is zero as an integer. So this is an element of R. So R is closed under both subtraction and multiplication. Therefore, R is a subring of the bigger ring M2Z by the subring test. We're done. Praise the Lord. Okay. So it turns out it works. What would have happened if it had not worked? You might have gotten, something, if it was some different problem, you wouldn't necessarily have gotten an integer in the upper right corner, or maybe you would have gotten something non-zero somewhere else. And effectively, you could argue if that had happened, that would have been a proof that it's not a subring, though it's also good enough to prove it's not a subring by taking just one example with particular numbers. That would have been fine as well. But yeah, this is kind of strange. Take any two elements of this subring, which is a ring, it's a subring, and multiply them, you get zero. That should seem strange. In fact, that also means if you square any element of this subring, or cube it, or raise it to the fourth power, or whatever, you're going to get the zero matrix as well. In particular, if you think of this matrix as a variable x and square it and ask for all solutions of this equation in this subring, there are infinitely many solutions. Not like what happens with numbers, right? X squared equals zero has just one solution, x equals zero. In this subring, which also means in this bigger ring, there are infinitely many solutions of this real simple polynomial equation, not just one. Weird. Yes, I keep emphasizing this. Ring theory is weird, at least in the most general setting. We mostly actually want to avoid weird rings, though we want to be aware of them. We like rings that are not too weird, because when the rings get weird, like unexpected things happen and it's just kind of hard to get a handle on. So we like and mostly focus on rings that are not too weird. They're called integral domains and fields. I'll say that again. Rings that are not too weird are called integral domains and fields. We like those, but we need to be aware of rings that are not integral domains and fields, and that is technically part of what we're doing here, though it's not our main point of emphasis. Any ring element whose square or whose cube or whose fourth power is zero actually has a special name. It's called a nilpotent element. Nilpotent element. It's an element of a ring such that if you raise it to a power, it's a non-zero element of a ring such that if you raise it to a non-zero power, well, any power, you get the zero matrix. Not that any power will give you the zero matrix, but some power, some integer power of it gives you the zero element. That's called a nilpotent element. There are also elements called idempotent elements. I love those names. Nilpotent and idempotent. Idempotent elements. Are elements typically taken to be non-zero elements, such that when you square them, you get themselves. Okay, I suppose you could say zero is nilpotent as well, but we're mostly interested in non-zero nilpotent elements. Zero would be idempotent as well, but we're mostly interested in non-zero idempotents. We're also mostly interested in idempotents if they exist that are not the unity one, the multiplicative identity if it exists.